Now the title is this one, When the Laser Was the Loser, actually with the subtitle, I cannot give you here an historical account of the laser because that would take too much time, so I will limit myself to a few curiosity and anecdotes on the laser. So the plan is, first of all, to talk about the rays which occurred more than almost 60 years ago to make the first laser. Then I will talk about early development in laser science, early development in laser applications. And then, where are we now? What is the present situation? And I will talk a little bit about the Nobel Prizes being given to people working with laser or doing research by laser. And I will reach a few conclusions. Now, the race started in 1958 with this by now very famous paper, perhaps the most famous paper in our field, by Shallow and Towns, in which they proposed to extend the Maser idea, which was already developed in 1954, to the infrared and visible range. And the race started mostly in the US with several laboratories, in particular Bell Labs and TRG, who invested somewhat like $1 million each to make the first laser, because there was a general consensus, I remember those days, that whoever would make the first laser would immediately win the Nobel Prize. And also there was some activity in Soviet Union. But the winner was a somewhat unknown person, and Theodor Maiman, at that time he was 33 years old, and this occurred on May 16, 1960. This is why we are celebrating today the Day of Light, being today the 16th of May. But the scientific community was astounded for at least three reasons. The simplicity of the component used, because everybody, the consensus of those days was that since the laser was not yet invented, that would immediately imply that making a laser would have been very, very difficult. So the simplicity of the component used, the three-level nature of the transition, ruby laser, as I will show you later, has got a three-level transition, and so it was very difficult to make a laser. Actually, there was a public statement by Arthur Shallow, who was one of the gold people in those days, stating that ruby laser would never work. And the type of laser excitation, namely by a flash lamp. But what is another important curiosity, that Maiman, a young scientist, won the race with a limited invested by Hughes, about $30,000 against $1 million invested by both Bell Labs and TRG. Here we see Maiman holding the first laser. So you see the very simple component, a flash lamp, a helical flash lamp with a small ruby rod inside, and the mirror were attached on the rod. And here there was an holder, an aluminum holder. And now it's interesting to read the account that Maiman has made about his discovery. I like particularly this description, because in my opinion is very naive. It was in the afternoon of May 16, 1960. It was a time to confirm or deny all the fears of why the ruby can work, or why laser can be made to work, the comment that I made before. No more calculation, no more diversionary experiment. This was the moment of truth. We turned up the power supply to 500 volts. We fired the flash tube. Indeed, we observed a trace on the memoscope. The trace was a recording of the red fluorescence ruby. The decay in the trace was about 3 milliseconds, the lifetime of the upper possible level. But when we got past 950 volts on the power supply, everything changed. The output trace started to shoot up in peak intensity, and the initial decay rapidly decreased. Voila! That was it, the laser was born. And that's contained in the book that Maiman published by himself. He sent to me a copy in those days. The Laser Odyssey, nobody wanted to publish this book because it was very big, bitter against Shallow and Towns. And the reason, in part, is understood here. Physical Letters rejected his first publication. Very likely, this is the biggest mistake that a scientific journal has made in the history. But a paper of similar content was accepted by Nature, an equally important journal at that time, two months later. While the paper was rejected in June by Physical Review Letters, Maiman and the group of Hughes believed that that was the art of somebody else outside, namely people from Bell Labs, Shallow and Towns, that wanted to kill him. So they decided to organize a conference press in New York to announce the achievement. This is one of the very first cases I know that one makes a conference press about an achievement before the publication of the paper. But they were very afraid about this. During the press conference, a more extensive copy of the paper was taken away from the desk of the conference and published on a somewhat unknown journal, British journal. This is why, whenever you see accounts of those early days, the achievement of Maiman is referenced to these two papers, one by Nature and one by British Communication and Electronics. And so they organized this press conference in July, while the paper, Nature paper, of course, in August. It was July 7 in New York. And they published official publication showed this laser, which is the picture which appeared the next day on New York Times. But this was not the true laser. If you look back again, it's completely different from the previous one. You see, this one has got only 3 turns of the helix, and it's much smaller. And the reason for it is that they hired at Hughes in Malibu a very famous photographer. And when the photographer saw this small component, says, I'm not going to make a picture of the first laser with this component, because this looked to me like some component of a plumber. And so he saw this big flash tube with a long, much longer ruby rod and say, that's it. But this is not the right laser. Don't worry, I want to take the picture with this kind of laser. And what happened that the day after this press conference in which all scientists were there, was immediately duplicated by the people, in particular TRG, IBM, and Bell Labs, the same laser. And actually, it worked much better than the original one published by Maiman. This is why for several years, at least for 50 years, some people at Bell Labs have been claiming that it was not Maiman who made the first laser, but it was theirs. But I don't think this was true. But anyhow, this is a long story that I don't have time to talk. So the end of the laser, though this laser, may be established by the end of 1960, December 60, And these are the main milestones. As I told you, May 16, the first laser demonstration. A couple of months later, Peter Sorokin, once he understood that it was the flash tube, not a CW lamp, the real breakthrough, he went back because he was trying to make these two active medium lasing. He went back with a flash tube and immediately got laser action on uranium calcium fluoride and samarium calcium fluoride. And this realized a few of first achievement was the first, these were the first two four-level lasers, first two, Ruby was a three-level laser, the first rare earth laser, samarium, but on the dark side, to have it working, you need to use cryogenic temperature. That's why after a few years, nobody worked anymore on this laser, but it was the second and third laser of the history. And the fourth laser, by December 1960, was by Ali Javan at the Bell Labs. He made a helium neon laser in the transition 1.15 micron transition operating. And this again realized at first a series of first achievement was the first CW laser, the first gas laser, and the first electrically excited. So this means that by the end of 1960, quite a different type of laser were operated. And so the laser was considered now an open issue. And so this opened the door to all successive developments. And this is what I call the working horse of laser physics for at least 34 years afterwards, the Ruby laser. That's the picture which appeared on Scientific American by a review paper published by Shallow. You will see the big flash tube with a long Ruby rod and the beam, out of beam. This was the first laser that I realized here at Polytechnic School, that was February 1963, but actually I'd been staying at Stanford from 61, where I made the real first laser at Stanford. Now, let's talk about a few early developments in laser physics. Broadly speaking, in the first 10 years of laser development, it was, I remember, a very exciting period because everything we made was new. Most important new lasers and phenomena related to laser physics were developed in those days, in those 10 years, like the study of relaxation oscillation, the concept of Q-switching, mode locking, the way of achieving single mode of oscillation. A most important phenomena related to interaction between the beam and the matter, like the nonlinear optics, high resolution spectroscopy, ultra-fast optical science, which then become a wide field of investigations. So it was a very exciting period. Now let's talk about early development in laser applications. And here, I remember it a very frustrating period, because essentially, everything which was tried application-wide failed. You may know that three of the most important fields nowadays are in medicine, optical communication, and material working. Now, since the beginning, many people tried to use laser for medicine, in particular for retina photocoagulation, which is now a common application, for port wine stain or vascular disorders in general, and for melanoma even. They were relying, hoping on some magic, perhaps, property of the laser, so the laser could try to cure even this very difficult and important disease, which is the melanoma. Now, for retina photocoagulation, for instance, we used, and I used personally also, with Professor Frankhauser in Bern, here in Switzerland, ruby laser, which was the laser mostly available on those days. Now, the ruby laser was wrong for at least two reasons. First of all, it was emitting a red beam, and the red beam is not absorbed by red blood cell. You need a complementary color. You need green beams. And it was pulsed, which was also a mistake. So essentially, we did not try on humans. We tried on rabbits. And essentially, what the ruby was doing on the retina was blowing up the retina. So when we make the first five rabbits blind, we decided to stop. The same thing happens for port wine stains. For melanoma, it was even worse. As far as I know, nobody tried in Europe, but in the United States, for at least the first 4 or 5 years, they tried to use both ruby and neodymium against melanoma. But these were pulsed laser, and what happened, that this shot given by the laser was splashing melanoma cell all around in the air. And these cells were viable, so they were very dangerous, both for the patient and for the doctor. So when the people realized that, they stopped immediately everything. And again, for optical communication, everybody was hoping to use lasers for optical communication, but nobody knew which kind of laser to use, because these were mostly laser being used. But for instance, gallium arsenide was already there, a semiconductor laser, but it was a homojunction laser, and this required cryogenic temperature, liquid nitrogen. Now, you cannot conceive to use repeaters with cryogenic temperature all along the communication pathway. So nobody knew which laser to be used, and optical fibers were already available at those times, because they were used for endoscopy. But the optical fiber of those days had an attenuation of the order of 1,000 dB per kilometer, very strong attenuation. So nobody could conceive to use optical fiber, and nobody could conceive, because they were very lossy, and nobody could conceive to use a semiconductor laser, because they needed cryogenic temperature. That was the situation. Although at Bell they were using hollow fibers or the periodic gas lens, they made quite a lot of experiments, field experiments, to do that. For material working, the laser, the highest power available at those times was the slow axial flow CO2 laser invented by Patel. But this laser, for a fundamental limitation, could not deliver more than 50 watts per meter independently of the diameter of the beam. And so this again was a strong limitation. This is why in those days the laser was named either a bright solution looking for a problem, or, as I call it now today, that the laser was a loser, because it was losing everywhere was applied. And to exemplify the difficulty in those days, this is a 2 kilowatt laser that the military developed in those days. You see, you have the limitation of 50 watts per meter. So the military calculated with some difficulty that in order to have 2 kilowatt, you need 40 meters long. And see, the military, you know, are straight mind people. And they decide to make a 40 meter long CO2 laser. And that was the laser they made, which was declassified a few years later. That was given 2 kilowatts. But then a magic turning point occurred in the middle of 70, essentially, 10 years later. Look, for medicine, retina photocoagulation, argon laser was invented by about the end of the 60s. And so it was applied very successfully for this application. Port wine stain and general vascular disorder, dye laser were invented by Sorokin and Schaefer, by the end of 60s, and they were successively applied, and of course melanoma is better not to talk to it anymore. Optical communication, double heterostructure semiconductor laser, which operated at room temperature, were developed essentially by Alfero, upon a suggestion made by Kramer a few years before. That's why Kramer and Alfero in year 2000 got the Nobel Prize. Optical fiber, thanks to the very inspiring work done by Kao at the British telephone company, and the announcement of Corning in 1970 to have achieved 17 dB per kilometer, which was a big breakthrough, it became clear that the source had to be the double heterostructure semiconductor, and the beam was to transfer through optical fiber. For CO2 laser, a fast longitudinal flow CO2 laser was invented in late 70, and that changed completely the paradigm of material working. And just to give you an idea, this is a modern high-power CO2 laser, fast flow. The dimension here is 80 centimeter by 50, and this laser can give up to 20 kilowatt output power, which plenty more than what is needed for material working. So the situation changed completely by the end of 1970. And this is a modern laser lab in my lab, and this is where we started. Here you see we were very poor, wood benches and very, very small equipment. We were poor but enthusiastic in those days. Now we are rich, but with some age. Now, during the time I have here, I don't have the time to go any deep to the application of lasers, so I need only to count to inform you. Information technologies is one of the big fields, including optical fiber communication, but not only that. Think about laser printer, optical discs, and so on. Manufacturing is a big field now, including cutting, welding, and piercing hole, making holes, and melting of the materials, including 3D optical materials. Medicine is a big field again, not only ophthalmology, but also dermatology, urology, endoscopy, and so on. And space and homeland security, what they say, they call it in this way, they are shy now. In the early days, they were called military applications. And last but not least, scientific applications, which essentially there is no field, scientific field, in particular in physics, biology, also biomedicine, which has not been influenced very heavily by this revolutionary application. And just to show you the importance, right now, Nobel Prize has been awarded to 30 scientists working with the lasers or using the laser for applications. So just to conclude this slide, I limit myself to a sentence that Barack Obama sent to us when we celebrated the 50th anniversary, that was in San Jose in May 16, 2010. And then he sent us a letter, I was there. The laser has changed the way we live. And I believe this is the right sentence to show you the application of lasers. Now, I want now to progress a little bit about an historical remark about the Nobel Prize. Again, I don't have the time to talk about the history of this Nobel Prize. That would take a long time. But just I limit myself to a few curiosities and anecdotes also in this field. Now, a first period from 1960 to 1990, for the first 30 years, very few Nobel Prize were given to the to our field, starting only for the first one, which was in 1964, given by Towns, Prokhorov, and Basov, and the motivation was saying for fundamental contribution for the Maser and Laser idea. That was the understanding of the sentence. Now, there was a lot of discussion in those days what was the meaning of this sentence, because the Nobel Committee is always very careful in phrasing a sentence. Now, was it given for the Maser, which at that time was even more important than Laser in 64, or to the Laser? No, it was Maser dash Laser. And that it was for the idea, because it was made in 1964, but Maiman was not one of the winners. Why? Because they wanted to stress the idea rather than the practical realization, the more so because the Laser at those days was called a bright solution looking for a problem. Nobody knew what was it for. So it was important to give the prize for the idea. But this has given a lot of problems later, because there is a general accepted criterion that the Laser cannot, and the Nobel Prize cannot be given twice for the same invention of discovery. So once it was given for the Maser and Laser idea, that many people say that is the end of any other Nobel Prize given to the Laser, because the Laser has already got his Nobel Prize. So for the future Nobel Prize which are going to be made to the field, always the Nobel Committee had the problem not to mention, or to mention in a somewhat cryptic way, the word Laser. So it was in such a way that in 1981, so nearby 20 years later, the Nobel Prize was given to Blomberg and Shalow. But actually, Blomberg and Shalow had given a very important contribution to the Maser and Laser. Shalow, because he was the co-author of Towns of that paper, and Blomberger, who invented the first real and working Maser amplifier. But the two were not considered for the first Nobel Prize. So in a sense, 20 years later, they got a Nobel Prize also them, but the motivation does not mention again Maser and Laser, but they say for Laser spectroscopy. Laser spectroscopy is okay because it's not a Laser, but it's spectroscopy done by the Laser. And then we come here, the period, a very important period, so that in only 5 years, there were 12 people awarded the Nobel Prize. In particular, Ahmed Zewail for chemistry, the other are for physics. And in particular, we see here Zoris Alferov and Herbert Kramer for the double ultrastructure Laser. Everybody knows that they got the Nobel Prize for the double ultrastructure Laser, but the official motivation does not mention the word Laser, but it mentions for developing semiconductor ultrastructure used in high-speed electronics and optoelectronics. And I also put it in red because now many years have passed since then. It was in year 2000, almost 20 years. I was named by the Nobel Committee for that year as an expert to assign the Nobel Prize in that day. And since the Nobel Committee liked very much my report, because I worked for 3 months and I made a 200-page report. There were 25 proposals for many people for the Laser. And so they invited me to the Nobel ceremony. And this is the invitation by the Nobel Committee in that time. Now you see here a few curiosity again. I was invited also with my wife. So we are invited as Professor and Mrs. Osvaldo. I don't know why, but that's the rule, apparently. And then another curiosity. The award ceremony was on December, I don't know if you can read it, December 10, 2000. And I wish to note you to notice that every year the Nobel Prize is given on December 10, because that corresponds the anniversary of the death of Alfred Nobel. So every year is made on December 10. And then you see here the prescription, white tie entails. It took to me some time to understand what tie entails means. It means this kind of clothing that I had to wear that was in the concert hall of Stockholm on December 10. Then period number three, you see Charles Kao, the one I was telling you before. And then we come to the last period, again rich of Nobel Prizes, from 2014 to nowadays. In only 4 years' time, we had in 2014 two Nobel Prizes, one for chemistry and one for physics, both assigned to the laser field. Then we had, in 2017, the Nobel Prize for the gravitational wave detector that detected the first gravitational wave. And of course, you cannot detect this way without using very, very sophisticated laser, high power, very, very narrow bandwidth lasers. And then we come to the last Nobel Prize, just last year, last December, to Ashkin, Giramuru, and Donna Skriken for a groundbreaking invention in laser physics. Okay, it's physics of laser, it's not laser, but it's kind of a schematage. And here again, I was invited by the Nobel Committee for the ceremony. And you see, formal attire, again, white tie entails for men, or national costume. It's accepted also that one comes with very high level national costume. I will show you an example of this. I was there, so here I am again with some age. Last December, this is in Grand Hotel of Stockholm, which is one of the funniest hotel. Moro Nisolo was also invited there, so he remembers this. Actually, he made you know, his wife made the picture. And here is the moment when Gerard Mourou received the Nobel Prize. Here is the King Gustav XVI, and here is Gerard Mourou. Now, since I have some time, I can a little bit digress about this picture, a little bit. Now, let's see about the stage here. The stage you see here to the left, in the front row, you cannot barely see here, we will see it better in another picture, the Nobel laureate. In that year, there were 10 Nobel laureates. In the back, there are previous Nobel laureates which have been invited, particularly invited for that ceremony. On the back here, you have all Nobel committee. There are six people in each committee. You have a committee for physics, for chemistry, one for physiology and medicine, one for peace. And this year, the Nobel Prize for Literature was not awarded for a scandal which happened in the committee. So this is the situation. Now, the ceremony goes like this. The chairman of the Nobel Committee, in this case physics, comes to this stage and talks about why the Nobel Prize was given that year for that particular topic. And then after finishing his laudation, by the way, here on the back, here on the right, there are the king, the queen, and on the back, you cannot see it, the princess to the crown, as they call it, Princess Victoria, who is going to be the queen when King Gustav XVI will pass away. And then, after the chairman of the Nobel Committee talks in general, then he asks these people to stand up and proceed to receive the Nobel Prize. Then at the same time, the kings moves from here and reach this position. The Nobel laureate moves from their seat to this position. Then he receives the Nobel Prize. Then the king steps back. The Nobel winner moves toward the public. Then everybody is applauding. The television of coming from all the world are making pictures and so on. By the way, another curiosity, you can notice here, and you will notice in the next movie, the beautiful flowers which are there and which are everywhere, here and many other places, including the castle where we were invited for the dinner afterwards. Now, since Alfred Nobel died on December 10, but he died in Sanremo, since the beginning of the Nobel Prize history, namely 1901, since that beginning, Sanremo is providing the flowers, the city of Sanremo is providing the flowers for the stage and for the castle, for everything. And then there is here on the back, you cannot see it, the orchestra, because after each Nobel Prize, there is a symphony and something like that. That's the situation. And so, here I will show you the movie.
Dr. Rashkin, Professor Mourou, Professor Strickland, you have been awarded the 2018 Nobel Prize in Physics for your groundbreaking inventions in the field of laser physics. On behalf of the Royal Swedish Academy of Sciences, it's my honor and great pleasure to convey to you our warmest congratulations. I now ask you to step forward to receive your Nobel Prizes from the hands of His Majesty the King.
Now the king is moving, and ask Gérard Mourou to move.
Gérard Mourou.
There is a very strict ceremony.
Born in France. Also receives his prize.
Actually, let me say that it's just 1 minute ceremony, but it's 1 minute which is worth all your career. So I wanted to, you know, to talk a little bit with some details about this, with a wish of some of you who may reach this very important achievement. And so let me reach my conclusions. The laser at the beginning was named a bright solution looking for a problem, or actually the laser was the loser. The laser now, the bright solution for many problems in science technology. It certainly must be considered now one of the most important inventions of last century. That this scientist is awarded by the Nobel Prize. It's going to play an even important role, I predict, in this century. That's why I can conclude that the best is yet to come. Okay, thank you very much. curiosities.
Can I ask you one question?
Yeah.
Just from your feeling, what do you think about the new lasers that they are made by organic materials, or all these new materials that they are coming now as a fashion? Do you believe that they have a future?
Well, organic is always been there for, including organic laser, not now, since 30 years have been there. The only problem is the degradation of the organic material. But if you can find organic material which have got a strength enough not to decompose after perhaps a million of shots, if this pulse, this is okay. The problem is the lifetime of the material.
Thank you.
Making waveguides is okay with organic, but the deterioration of organic is a problem. It's always been a problem, not only for the laser, but also in nonlinear optics. People have been developing very efficient second harmonic generator by organics, very efficient. But again, the problem was the lifetime of the material.
Do you believe that the challenge of electrically pumped this system will be ever overcome?
Electrical pump organic, yeah. You mean? Again, electrically pumped puts some additional stress to the material because you are having electron passing by, but there are conductive organic which can conduct quite well. So I think electrically pumped is okay. The lifetime is again the issue.
Thank you. Any other question? So before we thanks again Professor Svelto, I would like to call all of you to have a photo with the professor, because it's a unique opportunity to have, you know, such a person among us. So if you don't mind,
sure,
you know,
sure. Can we probably
one of them will be the next Nobel Prize.
Let's hope. So we remember.